our next session titled Regional Connectivity and Stability. The moderator for this session is Mr. Haroon Sharif, and he will be in conversation with our guest speakers Hina Rabbani Khar, Anatol Lieven, Nasim Zehra, Omar Zakhilwal, and Jean-François. Please switch off your mobile phones or put them on silent mode. There will be a question and answer session at the end of the discussion. We have designated a book signing area outside Parveen Shakir's speaker lounge. We would appreciate if complete silence is observed while the session is in progress. Sharif, who is an economist who works as an advisor to the World Bank Group on regional economic cooperation in South Asia, working with top policymakers to improve the authorizing environment and connectivity for regional economic cooperation. He plays a lead role in opening up a regional energy market, enhanced trade and investment, and policy dialogue.
Well, thank you very much for the kind introduction. A warm welcome again. We had a very useful session in the morning, which looked at the wider geopolitical issues and developments in the region. This session particularly will focus on economic connectivity, regional connectivities, issues, aspirations, challenges, and more importantly, how this can actually become a reality in this region. As an economist, when we look at economic literature about South Asia, very clearly this region missed the boat when East Asia was growing in the 80s. Now, lots of people think that basically the changing dynamics of the region, some of those which we addressed in the earlier session, is another opportunity basically to put South Asia on the global economic map. And a number of factors are supporting it. For instance, you know, China's predominant role, Asia emerging at center of gravity. So with that economic center of gravity, so that is where countries need to reposition themselves to take advantage of this changing narrative. So with this introduction, we have a very eminent group of panelists. We are very fortunate. We have Ambassador Omar Zakhilwal, Dr. Omar Zakhilwal, who is the former finance minister of Afghanistan. We have one of the top security analysts, Nasim Zehra, and a journalist. We have Jean-François Cautain, the ambassador of European Union. Hina Khar does not need an introduction. I'm introducing her again, the former foreign minister of Pakistan. And Professor Anatol Lieven, who is currently at the Georgetown University. I hope I named everybody. So I would start, basically my first question is to Ambassador Zakhilwal, because as Iqbal said, and we keep on saying, Afghanistan is the heart of Asia. So basically in this particular, you know, changing geopolitical dynamics, the revival of Afghanistan economy and stability and the wider role in the region, so how do you see what is the vision, what are the aspiration, challenges, and opportunities? So if you could have about 5 minutes on that.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Let me first thank the organizers of the 4th Islamabad Literature Festival for inviting me to be part of this very prestigious panel and also, of course, this very interesting topic in discussion. Of all the discussions, of course, that I've had over the past couple of months here in Islamabad, this is very close to my heart. It's about economics, it's about regional connectivity. And its relations to stability. And it's a topic that unfortunately has not received the due attention. First, of course, a few words that everybody familiar with is about the region. We are in a region that has in our immediate neighborhood a quarter of the world's population. 40% of the world poor we are host to. At the same time, of course, our region is endowed with diverse complementary resources and abilities, which is best for supply chain integration. For example, if we look into Central Asia and South Asia, and South Asia immediately here, Pakistan, Central Asia is endowed with abundance of energy and oil and gas, something that Pakistan has a shortage of, and so does India. So connecting these two, and of course in the middle is Afghanistan, which has not only energy resources, but is endowed with mineral resources and everything you name it that could certainly feed in to the production capacity and enhance the production and manufacturing capacity of those countries who are leading in that area. If we look into the potential of connectivity, again, first for economics and then for stability, of course, and we take Pakistan as an example, because we are in Pakistan, we want to make this topic relevant here to this audience. If Pakistan had freer and easier access to Central Asia, and if Pakistan energy requirements were met from there, and it could have, if we had, for example, projects such as TAPI, that is the Turkmenistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and Indian gas pipeline, if we had the projects such as CASA, that is the Central Asia, South Asia, power connectivity, if we had projects such as TUTAP, that is again, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Afghanistan, Pakistan, energy connectivity, and similar other projects. Pakistan economy over the past 10 years, if it had realized earlier, could have grown 4 to 5% more than what's growing right now. Right now, we all know that the economic growth in Pakistan is about 4% or maximum 5%. That would have meant to the ordinary Pakistanis that Pakistan's national income and therefore per capita income could have doubled in Pakistan every 14 to 17 years. Mind you that right now the per capita income of Pakistan as well as Afghanistan in the region is one of the lowest in the world. Yet despite these needs, despite the challenges, despite the needs, despite the opportunities, our area, our region remains the least connected. Of course, because of this least level of connectivity has fed into our development, and therefore we are developing is a political correct word. We are one of the least developed countries of the world. Connectivity, of course, if we look into our intra-regional trade of all the regions in the world, the share of our trade between ourselves is the lowest at about 5%. That's half of what the intra-regional trade in Africa is. That is half of what the intra-regional trade in Middle East is, which is still low, and compare that to 70% intra-regional trade in Asia, in Europe, sorry, and compare that to about 50% intra-regional trade in North America, and about 30% intra-regional trade in Latin America. The issue is not shortage of ideas. Of course, we have plenty of ideas, and I mentioned a few of the projects that are relevant to both Pakistan and Afghanistan. The CASA 1000 project, the TAPI project, the TUTAP project, and many more. Railway-related projects, the CARIC, the highways, and all those. So there is no shortage of ideas. There is no lack of knowledge with respect to the benefits of these projects. There's also no shortage of forums. Again, related to Afghanistan and Pakistan, there's ECO, Economic Cooperation Organization, RICA, Regional Economic Cooperation of Central Asia, Heart of Asia Forum, CARIC Forum, SARC Forum. So we have plenty of those forums. And it's also very well understood. There's, if stability is to come to our region, if peace is to come to our region, it will have to be resulted from greater economic integration, connectivity, economic interdependence, and turning the current relationship into a positive win-win situation. The question then is, why is there no progress on ideas that are there and forums that are already formed and of course regularly meet, and the understanding that we all have and we all share, and of course we don't have disagreements with respect to the benefits, not only the economics but also the security and the stability. Here is a few things that of course I raise us to as the reasons as to why we have not progressed. Regional projects that I mentioned, they are all potential. They have not been actualized. So people have not yet been touched by them, and therefore, they are not relevant in domestic politics of our countries. And for that reason, our politicians do not feel compelled to push for their realization. So always, when I was the Minister of Finance, and I, of course, pushed some of these regional projects, my argument was that we need to realize at least one project, that people see the benefits of this project, and that one project for me was CASA 1000 project, so that people across countries create dependency on our side, dependency on benefiting from the transition, and Pakistan dependency on benefiting, of course, from using and utilizing the power, both for domestic purposes and also for industrial. In Central Asia, of course, they have excess electricity, so they could also earn some cash from that. The second reason, of course, to the extent our governments and our politicians have pushed, and I must say that the push has been sincere, as I've been part of, their push in their trials, of course, have had some, in my opinion, some flaws and faults. And I list five faults and flaws with the approach that our governments take with respect to regional projects. One, we put stability as a precondition for connectivity, rather than prefacing connectivity as a contributing to stability, so that connectivity could get more prominence. Two, stability is viewed solely as something that could be achieved by military operations and trying to resolve political disputes that are in the region. And we are just stuck there. We just don't make any progress. And if there is any progress, it's a progress to the reverse. It's not a progress forward. Third, stability related issues are pursued bilaterally and connectivity is pursued multilaterally. I believe if we reverse it, that stability issues we pursue multilaterally and connectivity bilaterally, we will have more success, because that way we will come down from grandiose type of projects to projects that are between two countries that could be achieved more quickly. And then of course when a few of those are achieved, we just connect them and there we will have the regional connectivity. And last, our international friends and donors have thrown little real support to connectivity within the region. I've said this before and I've said it again, if only 1% of the resources spent on fight against terrorism in our region was given to regional connectivity, that would be somewhere in the amount of $10 to $15 billion. If they had thrown $10 to $15 billion into regional connectivity, particularly between Afghanistan and Pakistan, we would absolutely be in an entire different world. with respect to peace, with respect to stability, with respect to economic development. Solutions. Again, five solutions I propose. One, deliver one project, one major regional economic project, so that people see the benefits for themselves, and they then become stakeholders and advocates for more, stakeholders and advocates for stability, not only in their own country, but in our neighboring countries on which our well-being depends. Two, we do need to separate economics from politics. In fact, we should give economics a chance to help politics. And for that, we need to start from removing soft barriers to trade, transit, and people-to-people contacts. Third, we need to make regional connectivity part and priority of our domestic development agendas. Right now, if you look into, again, the development of agenda of Pakistan or Afghanistan or of any regional countries, regional projects are not a domestic priority. Four, international partners consider investing in connectivity as part of their security and stability agenda for this region. And I will explain this further. And lastly, identify a few regional projects with one major donor, country, or international finance organization serving as the sponsor for their project, so that their country or organization can help both with the politics as well as the finances of that. The example, again, the best example we have for this, the reason that we push forward with CASA and that it now has a secured funding of $1,250 million to bring electricity from Tajikistan and Kyrgyzstan via Afghanistan into Pakistan was because the World Bank stepped forward and became sponsor of that project. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Zakhilwal. It was comprehensive. It has raised several obstacles and solutions, and I'm sure the panelists would like to respond to that. If there is very quick any response, please go ahead, and then we'll move to the next topic. Just an immediate. Anybody? No? Okay. Then basically what we are, you know, hearing very loud and clear is that separate economics from politics, look at least one transaction which is completed so that people believe in this region. Taking to that forward, you know, for years and years, outside world and investors particularly have looked at this region with the lens of conflict and security. Now we are talking economics. And with that, I would like to raise this question to both Nasim Zehra and Anatol Lieven, that how do you see the security dynamics happening and playing a role vis-a-vis economics? Or would you like to comment what Ambassador said, that don't look at from the security lens and keep economics separately? So please, why don't we start with Nasim and then Anatol.
Assalamu alaikum, everybody. Thank you, Haroon, and thank you to the organizers for inviting me. Starting with what Ambassador said in terms of leaving politics and security out and focusing on economics, I guess this is something that we have been struggling with in this region, and specifically Pakistan on the one hand. You have you have India on the east, you have Afghanistan on the west, and especially since the 80s we have a situation where Pakistan has not been able to break out of this mode of focusing on just security primarily, and obviously economics is something that has been important, significant. And if I was to come to where we are today, if we look at India, Afghanistan, and Pakistan, I think that in these three countries, we have governments which are led by individuals who certainly think that economics is critical and economics is important in terms of well-being of this region. if we look at our experience of the last 30 years, security and economics, it seems, can't be separated. While I agree with the ambassador that we in our region, we are, if we were to look at Pakistan, Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif trying to move forward on the economic front. Before him, you had the People's Party government that actually took forward the MFN process to almost, to the point of completion. You have in India, Prime Minister Modi, with all his baggage and background in the last 2 years of, animosity and not engaging and not reciprocating to the way the Prime Minister of Pakistan was kind of extending his hand for cooperation. You now see a changed situation in Delhi. And when you look at Kabul, in Kabul you have the Afghan president who has an economic vision. But in all three cases, we see a stalled situation, and that's where we come to the question of, how far can you move forward on economic integration without addressing security concerns? So where are we today in terms of security? In Afghanistan, after NATO's departure, you have security challenges within Afghanistan. Peace negotiations between Kabul and the Taliban is a critical factor. Then you have a war of sanctuaries that is going on across the Durand line in both countries. And within Afghanistan, you have, there is power play that is going on. The unity government is able to move forward, but not sufficiently. Then if you were to move to Pakistan, in Pakistan, Pakistan's role, whether we look at the war of sanctuaries or whether we look at the Taliban, talks between the Taliban and Kabul, that's a critical role. And hence, again, the defining factor in how fast this relationship would move depends to a great extent on these factors that I just mentioned. If we were to look towards India and Pakistan, you have had the Pathankot incident of a terrorist attack. What maybe it would be correct to say that perhaps we are also looking at the security situation in a transitionary phase, so that you have leaders in these three countries who understand that economics is important, economic integration is important, turning the transport corridors into economic corridors is critical, but that's not happening, and that's where we need to focus. And it may be correct, again I repeat, to say that there is an understanding in Pakistan that economic integration is important. In Delhi, you see that happening as well, but Pathankot and after that, Yadav factor, I don't want to exaggerate it. It's a critical discovery, but this is the way interstate relations engage and interact. So how will Pakistan and India deal with this problem and negotiate their way forward is what is important. In terms of Afghanistan and Pakistan, again, we have seen that in the last 1 year, the way security institutions led by the political leaders in both countries have tried to push the relationship forward, try and deal with issues of distrust. So unless you have greater trust, unless you have some convergence on security issues, you're not likely to make the needed progress on the economic front. And if I was to look at all these three countries, we can go into detail as to why it's important to have also an internal dialogue within countries. While we talk of interstate, I think intrastate, the way the institutions engage, in Pakistan, we have an asymmetry of power, obviously, between civilian and military institutions. And yet we see in the last government, when they wanted to push the MFN forward, they were able to take it very far. In this government's time, we've seen that on Pathankot, It's a positive move. For the first time, we saw that engagement at the top level is taking place in trying to resolve the issues that have emerged, and issue of terrorism. And again, that brings me to the compulsions that are there for integration, for looking at common architectures for security. And let me state here that the way we look at economic integration as a common good, security, common security perceptions, I think today have to be seen as a common good. And if you have major security divergences, then that's a common bad as we see it between the three countries. So perhaps this is where I'll stop. I think that we have to be, and in Q&A I'm happy to discuss this more. Economic integration depends to a great extent, its speed will depend on how far we are able to look at common threat perceptions. Terrorism is such a critical factor that affects all three countries. And perhaps, again, it would be correct to say that we are moving forward. With India, it would be correct to say one step forward and a step and a half backwards on issues of security. In the case of Afghanistan, perhaps there is one step forward and probably half a step backward. In terms of Afghanistan, there are issues within Afghanistan as well that have to be addressed, and I think Ambassador Zakhilwal will talk about that. He's best placed to discuss it. But we see that when there are internal power dynamics at play, like we have seen in Pakistan and continue to see to a great, to some extent, but we see the same thing happening inside Afghanistan. So institutionally being on the same page between policymakers is important. That leads us to then greater commonality in terms of looking at the security canvas and finding common spaces on the security canvas. It goes without saying that economic integration is critical. Look at the level of poverty in this region. Look at the demographic stresses in this region. Look at the way the world is progressing. Look at economic blocks, etc. So I think that advocacy is not needed. That's there. But why aren't we moving ahead at a greater speed? And my submission is that we need to work both internally among institutions in all three countries and the leaders in these three countries. We need tall women and tall men to
intervene.
Tall men and tall women to lead the process forward, and politicians not to get subsumed under old ways of moving ahead in terms of bilateral relations. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nasim. A different perspective, a detailed one. I would like to request Professor Anatol Lieven to comment on that. You spoke about the wider issues earlier, but I think this is pretty much specific to the region.
And very briefly, as I remarked at lunchtime, I think that one can, in certain circumstances, if the national economic interests are strong enough, separate security issues between states from economic issues. And I pointed to the example of East Asia today, where severe geopolitical tensions and territorial disputes do not obstruct vastly higher levels of investment and trade than exist in South Asia. Since energy is such an important part of the regional configuration here, I also pointed to the example of the Soviet gas pipelines from Siberia to Western Europe, built in the depths of the Cold War. So it is possible in principle, but in both these cases, there were tremendous economic interests of the states concerned involved. Of course, once these systems are in place, then the economic interests become entrenched in the regional order. What I think you cannot separate economic issues from is actual security on the ground. And I'm afraid that the existing security situation in Afghanistan, which is, let's face it, that of civil war, There is no other word for it but that, does not allow the great economic developments, except perhaps for Kaza 1000, though only if local communities, not just Kabul, but local communities along the way, including local armed groups, can be given a real stake in it. But an additional problem here, you see, is that because of the drastic downturn of energy prices and mineral prices, as a consequence of the stagnation of the world economy and the slowdown of China, the incentives for investors, including even state investors, to invest in a very insecure situation is greatly reduced. So before, you know, these projects on a large scale can take place, it is necessary to try to find peace in Afghanistan and to strengthen the Afghan state. As far as Pakistan is concerned, as we all know, there is a tremendous opportunity for Pakistan now. I mean, really the kind of chance that only comes around every one or two generations as a result of China's proposed infrastructure project. But it is extremely important both that Pakistan maintain basic security, or at least contain the security threats in Balochistan and along the Afghan border, and of course that the Pakistani state and private Pakistani enterprise prove capable of actually using this package successfully.
Well, thank you very much, Anatol. Now a very clear message emerging that security and economics, as Anatol said, has to run parallel. And linked to that, I would move on to former Foreign Minister Hina Khar. So in foreign policy, we spoke earlier that how it is being repositioned in the changes. And if security and economics are running parallel, obviously what dominates and what should dominate? And what are the chances of actually economics coming into as a priority in Pakistan's foreign policy? So over to you.
Okay, thank you. And you know, I think it's very challenging to be able to coherently deal with the subject that you are trying to make us deal with, because there's so many issues at so many multiple levels that we can get rather sort of whopped up in, you know, the confusion of all of that. So I'm going to try and simplify at least and go to four, some anecdotal, some long-term, and some, I guess, short-term. And to start with the fact that I believe truly that in the world, regions that we see which have generally done well, economics by the leaders has been chosen to trump politics. Okay, so a choice has been made that economics and the economic well-being of the people of that particular country and that particular region will precede and will take precedence over what are considered to be political slash security slash territorial national interest. And in being able to do that, they have actually served nationalistic interest, because to me nationalistic interest is to serve the people of that particular country. In Pakistan and the entire region, including of course the India, politics has always preceded economics. And I think a classic example in the Pakistani context, and thank you Nasim for mentioning it, and we take full credit in the Pakistan People's Party government for the MFN, you know, break away from the past, because in Pakistan there was an unsaid rule that, and I asked people who made this rule, because it wasn't the cabinet, it wasn't the parliament, so where was this rule made that we will not go on trade because trade is an India subject until Kashmir? So I said, I don't think trade is an India subject. Trade is a very much an economic prosperity is the Pakistani subject more than anyone else's. And here, as I promised, some anecdotal evidence. You know, for instance, we can talk, ever since I joined politics, 2002, 2004, I was Minister of State for Economic Affairs, dealing with some of the projects that we were trying to pursue at the regional level. And CASA and TAPI were always there. And so was IPI. So I'm talking 2002 onwards. These are actually even more historical, decades further away. Now, as I said in the previous session, opportunities do not stay there to be taken forever. Opportunities have to be embraced, and good things might come of it, or they just swindle away. Now, I convinced my Prime Minister that TAPI was, of course, exceptionally important, right? And I told him, no, I didn't need no convincing, we were already convinced, but I convinced him to allow me to go to Turkmenistan for the single point agenda to try and convince. By that time, we had heard that the Turkmenistanis were so, you know, fed up with the long delays that they were looking at giving that particular, you know, wealth to, someone else, to committing them to someone else. So as I went, and we had this long, nice discussion, goodwill gestures, etc., and when I told him of Pakistan's, you know, deep abiding commitment and how Pakistan and the rest of the region feels that this is really good for us, he just gave me a smirk and he said, you know, Minister, many people preceding you have told me exactly the same thing, right? You're not the only one, and I appreciate your gesture of coming here, but you guys started talking about it more than 2 decades back. Only 4 years back, the Chinese started talking about a separate, you know, similar project. Today, their pipeline is almost at our border, okay? And yours is still being negotiated as to what are going to be the terms and conditions, where are the investors, nothing, okay? So it's good to say nice things, and it's good to have grand ideas, but where is the implementability? Where is the coming together of these countries to be able to actually deliver on that? And on that particular point, I think, you know, for instance, if you were to look at Ambassador Zakhilwal mentioned RECA. You know, he talked about ECHO. I think you and I and probably people who follow this, you know, Nasim, Anatol, and many other people in this room might know about RECA and ECHO, but how many people in Pakistan know about it? Because RECA and ECHO, as Ambassador was saying, have not delivered to the people. There's no project, there's no train running, which is an ECHO train. I'm glad it's happening elsewhere in Iran, but not in Pakistan so far, right? So these things have to have a form, a life form before they become. Now, the other stream, which is exceptionally important and which is relevant to all these countries, unfortunately, is the implementation deficit. We don't have the state structures, unfortunately, in none of the countries. I mean, our bureaucracy, Indian bureaucracy, is pretty much as bad, you know, and all sorts of systems. So we commit, and then we are not willing to put our money where the, you know, we are not willing to put any money or any real political will behind it, and that, I believe, is a major issue. The third stream I'm going to talk about is what, again, he mentioned. Because I think I am somebody who has managed Pakistan's aid portfolio for almost 7 years, right? And I can tell you that there's no managing the aid portfolio, with all due respect to World Bank and ADB and all the bilateral donors, because it manages itself. It is led by the centers, by the parliaments of the giving country, not the receiving country. So I used to famously use the words, please support the system, do not subvert it. If you think my system is not good enough and ambassador's system is not good enough, don't work all the way around it and make it worse. Work through it and strengthen it, okay? But it ain't happening because they are following different agendas. I'm not saying those are hostile agendas. I'm just saying their constituency is different than delivering to the people of Pakistan. The delivery to the people of Pakistan will remain the abiding responsibility of the Parliament of Pakistan or of the government of Pakistan. So let alone, I would maybe give a suggestion, which is impossible, and in 100 years we will not see this happening, but I will still give it, right? That all the donors all over the world, we know all of the love, you know, billions of dollars that have gone into Afghanistan. Where are the traces of that? You know, why is the Afghan economy suddenly tanking as donors? So if these are projects which are long standing, etc., why is the Afghan economy tanking? So if all donors were willing to take out all of their money for the typical bilateral assistance and put all of these tons of billions of dollars in regional connectivity, because also when I talked about the implementation deficit, a big problem with that, corollary of that, is the fact that when you talk to Mr. Finance Minister, this one or the one which preceded him or the 10 that preceded him, as World Bank, and tell him we want to put $1 billion fund only for regional connectivity, he will beg you to bring it back into his budget. That's a fact, right? As having spent 2.5 years in Q Block certainly tells you what, you know, how they function. And so because their vision is limited to the next budgeting cycle, he's just balancing the books, not because of his accounting background only. That might be part of the reason, but more so because that's his job. He just has to currently, he doesn't have the resources to be able to think long term and to commit resources. And lastly, I would just like to say that we like to believe in this region, and certainly in Pakistan and certainly in India, okay, and I'm going to talk about certainly almost the entire region, that we are the only entities in the world which have territorial disputes with each other. that we are almost exception in the rule. And many people tell you, oh, you know, nobody has problems that India and Pakistan have with each other. Well, decades back, I think France and England would tell you the same. Maybe bigger problems, right? Afghanistan and Pakistan, you know, the type of trust deficit that we've been able to inculcate, no other two countries. No, guess what? All countries have had similar, if not bigger, smaller, in different proportions. However, as I said in the beginning, they allowed the economic progress, development, connectivity, integration to precede, not follow. So here we are sitting there harping on territorial disputes, increasing them as we go forward rather than decreasing them. You know, for instance, many of these things that you consider to be unfathomable are not that. And lastly, and this will be actually the last one, and I agree, the China infrastructure project is one big opportunity, and these opportunities don't come every day, and there are many, many big opportunities. Lastly, I think leaders, political leaders at the very, very top, so I'm talking Prime Minister Modi, Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif, and all the political leaders right at the very top, have to be committed to their long-term legacy, not short-term domestic votes, okay? And I'll give you an example on this, and this is across the board again, okay? And, you know, we've lost some opportunities. I think when Ashraf Ghani came as president, he came with an open heart and he came with a huge window which was open for Pakistan. Pakistan, I believe, let it close a bit. Pakistan can still pull it back, right? But we did not respond. When Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif, at the encouragement of the opposition parties also, went to the inaugural of Modi, he opened a window that Modi did not take. When Modi came to here, to Pakistan, to Lahore, again, that window was opened. And then Pathankot and Yadav happened. I want to say very clearly, Pathankot and Yadav are events. We cannot let events determine the strategy. Strategy is different than events. You have to make a demarcation. So when there's this big ground swelling of, you know, nationalistic sentiment that, oh, we have found that now we must, you must do what? Isolate yourselves from your neighbors. I don't mean isolation the way Indians means isolation for us, but I mean it. So, leaders will have to become, and the, you know, on that anecdotal, but Prime Minister Manmohan Singh, who we all know was deeply committed to Pakistan-India normalization, and he talked about converting Sachin into a mountain of peace, and I do not at all, knowing him fairly well, doubt his commitment to it. He was unable to deliver. And in a meeting that he was having with President Zardari, where only the foreign ministers were there, and two or three more people, he said in response to our invitation that, you know, it's been a while that an Indian Prime Minister comes, you need to come and create the environment so that normalization can start happening. You have to first create the environment for normalization. So he said to us in response to that, that, you know, the public opinion, I really want to come, but public opinion in my country does not support my coming. And I remember it's not normal when two heads of state, heads of government are talking for foreign ministers to intervene. But I know, remember, I could not contain myself and I intervened and said, with all due respect, Mr. Prime Minister, it is leaders' job to create public opinion for what needs to be done rather than follow it.
Well, Hina is always brilliant, detailed, excellent, and messages are very loud and clear. The leadership is needed, longer term, but in democracy, obviously, constituencies do matter. How leaders balance that, that's a challenge. Anatol, you had a comment on that.
We have a sign saying go to Q&A.
So we are going towards then the somebody whose region actually did it. So that is European Union. So we have Ambassador Jean-François Cautain, an old friend of mine. So please tell us, after listening to all of us, how did you do it? What did you learn? Is it working? Not? And basically, are there any lessons for this region?
Okay, thank you very much, Haroon, for... Actually, I would like to start with what you just referred, Hina, on the... Actually, not England on France, but I would like to start with Germany on France. When I was a young boy, my grandfather fought two wars against the Germans. And he could not stand them at all. And he was always referring to the German people with very slang words on our languages. My parents actually suffered from the Second World War, but they had a relationship with the German people, and I remember when I was a teenager, I traveled to Germany a couple of times. Me, I've never had any problems with German people. And if I ask our two boys what they think about Germany, they will look at us with, you know, what are you talking about? I mean, why this question? So my point is that the EU project, obviously, which started in 1951, actually, it's interesting because it started, as you know, after the continent of Europe was devastated by two successive wars. But it started on an economic project, actually. It was an economic project, but it was an economic project, a small one, which is called the European Community for Coal and Steel. Thank you. The idea of the project was really to lock the two main protagonists, France and Germany, that they will never find a way to fight again. That was the project. So it was an economic project, but with a very clear political goal. And it was a project which was actually imposed by political leaders of six countries over their public opinions. Let's be clear, we were in 1951, only 6 years after the end of the Second War. And there was nobody, you know, in France and Germany was ready, you know, to extend an arm to Germany, at least in the general public. So it was imposed by the leaders because they had this vision that this continent could never find peace if you don't lock at least these two countries and then after other countries together in a more a bigger project. So it started with an economic project but with a clear political vision of the region. And then where we are now, I don't need to explain everything, but in a nutshell, I mean, the EU is the largest economy in the world. The EU is a country where, it's a group of countries where you can travel wherever you want, where you are a citizen, where you can settle and work wherever you want. It's a country where goods and services freely travel, capitals as well. So that is, I would say, the internal market of the EU that everybody knows. It's also, you know, exchange of students, 2.5 million of students going to different universities all over the EU. Many interaction, many connectivity of all kinds, hard connectivity and soft connectivity. But what is most important, and I was just a bit concerned when you started the debate, Haroon, that we will be only talking about regional economy or regional economic integration, but clearly what is the most important achievement of the EU, and that was the vision of the fathers of the EU, it's peace, stability and prosperity for the people of the EU. If you look at the last 60 years, I mean, there have been no war between any EU member state countries. Obviously, we had our difficult time at the doorstep of the EU. We still have, actually, on certain fronts. I mean, I'm referring, for example, in the 90s to the war in the Balkans. So, obviously, that was a very difficult time for the EU because even the EU was not ready to tackle the issue. So now we have taken steps, not only because we are trying to see how we can integrate our neighbors, and talking about the Balkans, but also how we can, within the EU, we are not talking about security in terms of how we are not going to fight each other anymore. We are trying now building our own common security and defense policy. So we are in a very advanced stage in terms of integration. My point is, obviously, what is going on in the EU is probably not something maybe can be applied here, I don't know. It just maybe, as I used to say, the general Secretary General of ASEAN, you know, the EU is a source of inspiration for other regional blocs. So I hope that the EU can also, you know, bring in this part of the world some experiences. But again, I would like to relate very much to what Hina was saying. I think political leadership is key and a long-term vision. You are not to have, you don't have to look at the next election. You have to look at what is the best for your country, what is the best for the region, and you know that it's only by looking at that you will make the region stable in a sustainable way. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. A consistent and very useful message. We have around, we started 5 minutes late, so we have 12 minutes, although the young boy was showing me 10 for questions. So we'll take 3 questions in the first go. So gentlemen in the second row here. And then Dr. Manzoor.
Assalamu alaikum, Jay. Fahim from Pakistan Poverty Alleviation Fund. There was an article which came back in September 2015 about Pakistan being the zipper of Eurasia, being the pivotal point for Europe, Asia, and the Central Asia. And they talked about India. If India allows it somehow, then that can be a reality, and it has dividends for a lot of different countries in the region. My question is that, can that be a reality? Not now, but 10 or 15 years down the line. And it's not about optimism that, yes, it can happen, but it's about the right-wingers, would them allow this? Would the Kashmir issue, the Siachen issue, and then also US, because in this regard, Russia, China, Pakistan, and India would gain from it, but only one loser, if not loser, but US won't be happening, having much of a dividend. Can that be a reality, based on the ground realities we have in this region? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Could you believe in the front?
Thank you very much. Two questions, one from Madam Kerr and other one from Nasim Zehra. If you look at the last 25 years, we see whether it was PMLN or People Party or Musharraf government, they were all pushing for regional integration and giving MFN status to India, but none of them really managed it. You think it was just army stopping it, or there was public opinion as well, or some other reason? And from Nasim Zehra, I mean, very nice to hear all your comments here, but we never see such kind of discussion on our media. We never see media pushing it. If at all, it's on the negative side. Why is it that?
Thank you very much. I'll take one more question there, and then we'll come back for the second round.
Lohiz Ali from NAST. My question would be to Hina Rabbani Khan and Omar Zakhilwal. Well, we're talking about, both of you talked about the same thing, that whatever the money has been invested in Afghanistan and the security, if that was invested in connectivity or business or anything, it would have been better. But it did not happen. Do you see when the world economy is going down, when China's economy is going down, now the world will think, all right, India, Pakistan, China, these are the major areas that need to be like focused more than the rest of the world?
Well, thank you very much. Quick responses, and I'll start. Why don't you start, Hina?
Okay, quick responses. Can that be a reality? Yes, it can be a reality. Look, I look at it like this way. You don't have control over other people's actions, but you certainly have control over your actions, right? So I'm fully convinced that even if you have to unilaterally do certain things, and you know the fact that we did trade before Kashmir was taken back was a step in that direction. That you cannot wait. How will we get Kashmir? We cannot get Kashmir through war. If you're going to get it on the negotiating table, we need to create stakeholders in both. Trade, investment is the way to go. So do what you have to do without waiting for quid pro quo from their side, and that will ensure that maybe in your and my lifetime, we will see something like this. The second one was about PMLN government, PPP government, who's holding it back. Regional integration has been everybody's goal. I completely agree with you. It has been everybody's goal. And again, I think we wait too long. That's why I repeatedly mentioned two things which we did, which are verifiable, right? Because talk is good, but doing is more important. The fact that we renegotiated the Afghanistan-Pakistan trade agreement, which is still not working as well as it should be, which had not been renegotiated for a good few decades, showed that we need to do this in the real. The fact that we went towards converting the positive list into the negative list, and then literally the cabinet had already approved the MFN status, also proved that you need to go towards that way. Because if you're going to create the hardware for regional connectivity, the software, the tradability also has to be done. So I don't think the military, look, if you are going to allow the military to take, the military doesn't have a view on this. It should not have a view on this, right? It really requires political leadership to do what they have to do and not to complain about who's not allowing them to do. On MFN, I'll be honest with you, we did not need to engage with them because it's not relevant to their subject. It's not a relevant subject to them. Security with India, border issues, etc. are. But economics is not. Lastly, the question was, sorry, what was the question on the last question?
Okay. Actually for Dr. Zakhilwal and you about the money spent and on economics versus overall donor money?
Okay, that's not changing, because I'm convinced after spending five, 6 years in the economic affairs division that the money is going to come according to the dictates of parliaments and bureaucracies abroad rather than here. It ain't changing.
Okay, so Nasim, why don't you run these programs? Please answer the audience.
I'm very happy to answer this. I don't control the media of Pakistan. I control my own programs, and these things are discussed in my programs. Very quickly, the question about the army stopping. I think that, yes, we've had incidents like the Kargil blunder, which did obviously put the Lahore effort off track. So you've had those incidents, but I think Hina's completely correct. Ultimately, the person in power, in authority, and in this case Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif, you know, he can lead the process in the direction that he wants to and he's committed to. I mean, look at how the government has been functioning in the last 18 months. You've had one meeting of the National Security Committee. Big things happen and there's no institutionalized process to take things forward. Decision making plays a very critical role in how foreign policy and security policies are taken forward and led by the civilian political class. If the civilian political class is going to huddle in corners and go opt for that kind of decision making, then you will have the kind of issues that you have, that the army and agencies trying to push their own view across in public space. It's ultimately, I think, the responsibility of the political leadership, and we do not need pygmies, we need leaders to lead us out of this. Thank you
very much. Dr. Zakhilwal.
In response to the question on donors' interests, I mentioned that in the beginning that was one of the many factors, and the main factor was again highlighted very eloquently by Minister Hina Khar, that it's the politics that is the biggest killer of regional economic integration. And it's the politics that needs to be corrected. And it could not be corrected, in my personal opinion, unless the public of our countries become the stakeholders of the regional economic. Now here we will ask a question as to how much regional economic projects and issues has been a discussion of the national politics here, of the general public here. My own answer, based on, again, what I observe here and also in my country, very little. So therefore, this discussion, first of all, the general public needs to know how much they lose because of the lack of connectivity. And you actually can quantify that. I'm absolutely a strong believer, and the panelists and also economists would agree with me, that with greater integration, again, there are different levels of integration, the income of each and every one of us right here would be twice, three times as much. So we are losing twice, three times as much as what we earn. And that's our stake. But how much do we take that loss seriously to bring it to our politics or our demand of our politicians, and of course give it as a mandate to our politician, that as much as the domestic and national economic agenda that they present to the public during elections and all that, they also make regional economic projects an integrated part of that.
Well, thank you very much. We can take two very quick questions from these two people there, and then we'll close the session, because I think I've been warned we only have 2 more minutes. But please be very quick.
There have been speculations that CPAC, the reason our military has been taking a special interest in CPAC is because of the reason that our maritime security will be somehow dependent on China and India will be thinking twice, which has created a security dilemma in India. Do you think that these economic integration projects, as long as it will be taking or perceiving it in terms of security, will bring any regional integration?
Thank you very much. One more question, I think, from that side.
Yes, the my question is basically about the China-Pakistan economic corridor as well. That recent, largest as early as last week, Chief said that India is trying to sabotage the China-Pakistan economic corridor. So my basic question is that can we even guarantee the security of such a massive project? Can we guarantee the energy required for such a massive project? And can we guarantee the political will? Our political parties can't even agree on an Eastern and a Western project. How are they going to agree on such a massive scale project? No, yeah. And just one last thing, ma'am, this is from Hina Rabbani Khar especially. Ma'am, is there any chance that in my lifetime I can see our political parties evolving into anything sensible? Because even though you granted MFN status, Bilawal Bhutto Zardari in a couple of tweets washed it away by saying childish things again and again. So it's about the evolution of political parties. When are they going to grow up? We talk about these good things, we don't see them happening. Thank you.
Well, first of all, Pakistan did not grant the status. We were close to it. So very quickly, Anatol, would you like to answer the security question?
Well, I think this last point is absolutely critical. Because to go back to, you know, what the EU ambassador was talking about, various things in Europe have been set essentially by all the main political parties in key states as key and essential national goals. Now, I have to say, ever since I first came to Pakistan, now almost 30 years ago, I have looked for such consensuses in Pakistan and have sometimes found them. I think that finally in Pakistan, very belatedly, there has been a national consensus on fighting domestic insurgency and terrorism. But yes, I mean, the Pakistani political and military elites seem to have found it very, very difficult to come together behind, to agree on key national interests, even when, as with this infrastructure project of the Chinese, it's absolutely obvious that, that Pakistan's future depends on this to a considerable extent. It was heartwarming, really, last year. I was in Peshawar, and I was talking to students, some from the ANP and some from the PTI, and I pointed to all the things that need to be done in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, because they'd been disagreeing with everything else, arguing about it. And I said, look, here are some things on which both the main parties can obviously agree. What do you think are the chances that they might put politics aside and actually come together behind these projects? And as I say, it was truly heartwarming, because with one voice, both sides replied, absolutely impossible.
Thank you very much. Last 30 seconds, Hina, anything to add, or are you good?
I think I'm generally good, but on CPEC, look, and I guess I'm just going to respond to the last comment, because I think it's important not to shoo that away. Look, Pakistan has not had a pure democratic dispensation for more than, I think, altogether 3 decades, right, out of our 65 years. Give this political parties democratic dispensations, democratic structures, the civilian institutions will only grow when this is long-term happening in this country. And please don't take away, I'm completely fine with political parties arguing about which route to follow as far as they're able to agree on the certain route. Consensus building before starting a project is much more important than killing that project after it has been done. So I think this is a democratic dispensation. This is how it is. 18th Amendment to the Constitution, people agreed on impossible things. So please don't underestimate the importance of consensus building. It is important. It's a country of 180 million people. We can have different opinions. If we do not agree to, you know, eventually agree on something, then please judge us as much as you will.
Well, thank you very much. Jean-François, anything to add? Well, with that, I'm not going to sum up. The topic is wide. The purpose of this conversation actually was to understand different dimensions of regional connectivity. And I think each speaker in a very tight time schedule did wonderfully well. So a round of applause for everybody, and many thanks.
Thank you for attending this session. Our next session is Ek Sham Anwar Masood ke naam, and it will begin at 4:45 p.m.